We come before you today knowing that you defeated the grave. That God, nothing can hold you down, not even death. We can stand here today and say, oh death, where is your sin? Because it couldn't get to us because we died on the cross. God, if you call us to it, we know that we can live forever because of what you did. you rose again and for me. Save us, friend. Father, just thank you for that promise that we can live in today. That we don't have to be dead in our sin anymore. That we can come out of the grave. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for enduring that for me. Thank you.
front row seats available right over here if you need them. Thank you.
Mining West Spring Church. The Lord Jesus Christ is risen. We thank you for coming to worship with us this morning, to celebrate the resurrection with us this Sunday at this time. Kids grades 5 and under can be dismissed to go back to kids ministry. If you haven't checked them in yet, please go back and do so first. The worship team is going to lead us in another song as we prepare our hearts for the word this morning. And then after this song, onward, grades 6 through 8 will be dismissed.
More, and we need your help for this thing. If you want to clap a little bit, you're allowed to move. That will feature. Just I'm right. Any kids that are in onward, the 6th to 8th grade, can be dismissed at this time. Go ahead out there and find Pastor Joey. Everybody else, take a second to say hi to one another before you sit down. Maybe get to know someone on the opposite side of the room. Take a few moments.
Happy Easter, Kim. Happy Resurrection Sunday to everyone. We're just so thankful to have the opportunity to worship together with you and to celebrate the fact that Jesus Christ's tomb is empty and he is alive today and we are alive in him. Take some time and pray together this morning. Dear God, I just thank you for who you are, Lord. I thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, I thank you that we're joined together here today, whether in person or online, just remembering that Jesus Christ sacrificed himself for us and then rose again. Lord, that the finished work of the cross paid the price for our sins, and now the resurrection of Jesus raises us to new life again. And Lord, I'm just so thankful of that. And God, I just pray this morning that you would remind each and every one of us who you are and of what you've done and of who we are in you. Lord, people who, when we put our faith in Jesus, have been raised to new life. And Lord, I just thank you. And God, I pray this morning that as Pastor Jeff comes to bring the message, that you would put him aside, your spirit would speak in this place, that your name would be glorified. And that, Lord, as we go from here to whatever plans we have for today, Lord, I just pray that you would help us to take the message of an empty tomb and a risen Lord to the world that so desperately needs to hear it. Lord, I thank you and I love you. I pray this all in the name of the risen Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. We are very honored that you are here with us here at Wellspring to celebrate Easter. So thank you for joining us. I just have a few announcements, some things that we have going on here at Wellspring that we just want to invite everyone to be a part of. We love to see people connecting and becoming family here, and the best way to do that is to come to things outside of Sunday morning, and we have a lot of opportunities for that to happen. So the first thing I'm going to mention, I'm going to try to go through these really quick because I know it's Easter and we have important things to do, but our Wellspring Women's Group, our sister circle, we are breaking up into small groups, and we're really excited about that. It's always a good time. So we have sign-ups out there. If you're interested in to dive a little deeper and get a little more intimate with some of the women here, then this is a great opportunity. There's 6 different groups to choose from, so just go sign up for one of them, and we'll be in contact with you. That starts in May. Also, our Well Season Group, that's our adult fellowship that we have, they are going to be meeting April 30th. Mark your calendars. We'd love to see some more people after that. They have a potluck and just have fellowship, and it's a really great time. So mark your calendars for that. Also, the young adults are going to start meeting. We're excited. This is a brand new ministry that's starting. So if you're 18 to 28, we'd love to see you out. The first one right there, May 6th, right here, and come out. We're really excited. And Pastor Jared's going to be starting that up. And the last thing I want to mention, and we're really excited about this, special announcement. There's a new baby here at Wellspring. Asher Levi was born. If you know Faith and Fred, there are missionaries over in Africa, but Faith is here right now. She actually was here with the baby today. So we are really excited for her and her baby. But we ask you to pray as a church for Fred. He's still in Africa. We want to get him over here so he can see his baby, be with his family. So if you could pray that that would work out, that would be amazing. So make sure you congratulate Faith on her baby. All right, thank you.
evening, everybody. Good morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday. How is everybody doing? You guys awake? This is supposed to be like the Super Bowl Sunday of the Christian faith, right? So one day we all dress up and we get really excited. And there's a reason, because Jesus really didn't stay in that grave. He really did rise again. Amen? And, you know, this is one of those days we get to celebrate. So that's what the plan is today, is to celebrate the resurrection. It's one of those days where the dude gets to wear purple and get away with it. So, but the truth is, the tomb is empty, so the church should be full. The church should be full of people, should be full of love, should be full of grace, joy, peace of the Holy Spirit. And my prayer is that each and every one of you here, if you don't know Jesus, that today would be your day. Because I believe that God drew you here for such a time as this to hear this message. And we're going to be in 1 Corinthians 15 this morning. And as you're turning there, I want to start by giving you a riddle. Don't get mad at me. There were six crows that were sitting on a fence, and four of them decided to fly away. How many crows are left? What answer do you guys got? Two? All right, that's incorrect. And I'll tell you why at the end of the message. So you're going to let it leave until the end, right? If you really want to know. All right, we'll come back to that. Put it on the shelf. I know you hate that kind of stuff. Anyway, 1 Corinthians 15. The Apostle Paul is going to tell the believers in Corinth, and he wants the Holy Spirit wants us to know today that there is a decision that each and every one of us need to make. That there is, out of all the decisions in life, there is the most important decision, the most important thing to know is, what do you do with Jesus? What do you decide to do with this Jesus who died for you and who rose again? And decisions are something that really determine the outcome in a lot of our lives, right? You can decide to do certain things, and when you follow through with that decision, it can determine whether or not good things are happening or bad things are happening. Well, the same thing is with your eternity, that all of eternity hinges on your decision of what you do with Jesus. But we need to make a decision that follows through, and that's really what he's getting at here. And so 1 Corinthians 15, he says this: "Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, and on which you have taken your stand." So this is the gospel that he has preached to these Christians, that when they didn't know Jesus, he preached the gospel to them, and he said they received this gospel and they took their stand. I'm going to give everyone at the end of this message an opportunity, an invitation to receive Jesus. If you've never taken your stand for Jesus, I'm going to give you an opportunity to stand and accept Christ, and I want you to pray about that and allow the Lord to speak to you this morning. In verse 2, he says, "By this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preach to you. Otherwise, you've believed in vain." The idea there is, once you make this decision, this is not just a one-time decision. This is a lifetime commitment that you make, and you hold on to this truth of the gospel that Jesus died and he rose again for you. And that's what he goes into next, verse 3. "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." This is the most important thing that anyone could know. This is the most important decision that any one of us could ever make in our lifetime. This decision that he says, this is the most important, of first importance, is the gospel. He says, what is the gospel? He says that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And what does it mean when he says Christ died? He died for what? What does it say? He died for our sins. And we're going to talk about that. But I want you to understand, when Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just die a normal death, like just kind of passed away in his sleep. You understand, if you've ever read the scripture and the gospel accounts, that Jesus died the most painful death that any man would ever face. That as he was on his way out into the garden that night after he had been betrayed by Judas with a kiss, as he was in the garden and he gets captured and they capture him, and this is the night before he goes to the cross, he's captured and they do a mock trial, they do a false trial on him, and they accuse him of things that he never did. They falsely accuse him, they blindfold him, they basically put a pillowcase over his head and start beating him, punching his face, saying, if you're really a prophet, then prophesy who's going to hit you next. And they just beat him and beat him over and over again. And they ripped out his beard. They stripped him naked. They then shamed him. Then they robed him in purple, dressing him up like a king to mock him, to say, if you're really the king that you say you are, then let's dress you up like a king. And they put a purple robe on him. Then they make a crown of thorns, and they twist it, and they put it on his head. And then they put a mock staff in his hand. And then they take that staff out of his hand and take it and start beating it into the top of the crown of thorns in his head. And then they spit on him, and they worship him by bowing down and mock worshiping him and ridiculing him as he is on the way to the cross. Why? Because he's going to the cross to die for what? Our sins. He goes through all of that pain, and he still continues to go every step of the way toward that cross. They mockingly worshiped him. They spit on him. They continue to beat him over and over again. They scourged him. They tied him to a pole and whipped him over and over again, over and over again, to the point where his back was raw, that there wasn't even skin left in some areas. Then he could barely even walk. He couldn't even carry his cross. And it's estimated that the crossbar of the cross would have, at least the crossbar, if he was, you know, carrying that, could have been up to 200 pounds to carry that. And he collapses under it to the point where they have to call a guy to come and pick up his cross behind him and follow him, because Jesus can barely make it, but Jesus keeps going toward that cross because he needs to go there for the sins of the world, for us to be saved. Then after that, they finally get him to the place of Golgotha called Calvary, on the hill called Calvary, and they lay him down on that cross, and they take these giant metal nails and they pound them into his hand one at a time. Then they stretch his arm and pound the other one, very likely in the wrist area, because if it was any higher, it would likely fall. And then they take his feet and probably take one big long nail and hammer it into both feet. Every pound of pain that Jesus experiences was for you. It was for me. And I mean, how much pain does that take? Has anybody ever stepped on a nail? It's painful, right? But you know what? Jesus went through all of that for you and for me. And how much power does it take when you're the Son of God? When you're not helpless, like you could call 12 legions of angels down at any moment. You're the creator of the universe. You could just say, okay, everybody's done. We're just going to bag this whole thing up, this whole creation thing. We're just done with it. We're going to start over. He could have done that right then. But he chose not to. Because his love was the very force that was holding him there on that cross. It wasn't the nails. It was his love for you and me. And then they lifted up that cross, and as they slide that cross into the hole in the ground, and it slides down, and he hangs there on the cross. For 6 hours, he hangs on the cross, and there's 7 last words that he says on that cross, one of them being, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And then during that last 3 hours, from noon to 3, darkness covers the earth, and the wrath of God is being poured out on Jesus for the sin of the world. In that moment, he then says, it is finished, tetelestai, which means it is finished, and it also has the idea of paid in full. All of the sins of the world were paid. All of the debt was paid in full in that moment, and it says he breathed his last, and he gave up his spirit. And then, just to make sure that he was dead, a Roman centurion comes over and pierces his side where his heart was, where blood and water flows forth, indicating that Jesus died of a broken heart. Jesus died to have you. Do you know that each and every one of you in here, he wants you to know him. You are the reward of his suffering. Amen? The reason that he went to that cross was for each and every one of us. It says in Hebrews it was for the joy set before him that he endured the cross, scorning its shame. He didn't enjoy any bit of it, but the one thing that he looked forward to on the other side of that cross is the joy of knowing that you and me would be in eternity with him forever, that we would know him, that we would be forgiven of all of our sins. So when it says here in 1 Corinthians 15 that Christ died for our sins, I just want you to remember the way that Jesus died. It is the most painful way that he ever died. And this is important to understand, because I'm going to be talking about the fear of death and certain things like that today. And one of the things that we can always remember, even in our pain, even in the world that we live in, because death still is a real thing, even though Jesus defeated it, and we'll talk about that. Death still comes, and pain still comes, and sickness still comes. But there is no ounce of suffering that any of us will ever go through that Jesus didn't experience. We do not have a God that does not understand suffering. We have a God that has come down in human skin and walked in our shoes and experienced every ounce of suffering that could be experienced by humans. So this is the gospel, that Christ died for our sins according to the scripture, that he was buried as he was raised on the third day. And he was raised on the third day according to the scripture. See, that's what happened. It was God counting to three. When Jesus died on that cross, on, you know, Good Friday, God counts one, two, three. It's not over with God. Amen? It's not over. The third day he rose again according to the scriptures. It's interesting. The scriptures at this time that he's likely referring to are the New Testament accounts that were already written when it comes to, some of the gospel accounts were already circulating at this time. When the Apostle Paul writes 1 Corinthians, this is 25 years after Jesus dies on the cross. He plants the church of Corinth around 20 years, around 50 A.D., around 52, 53 A.D. He plants the church of Corinth, and then about 5 years later, he writes this letter to them, which means that this was still something that happened. He's going to say that there's still eyewitnesses that witnessed the risen Jesus in this day. But by this point, people already started writing scripture. And the question that we have during Easter is, what happened? Why did all of these people become believers in this Jesus if he didn't really rise again from the dead? If he didn't really die on the cross and he didn't really rise, then why did all these people just change their minds and become followers of Jesus? Why has all of history been changed forever from this moment on, some 2,000 years ago? And why? Why do we have the New Testament? Why do we have the Bible? It's because when they realized that this really happened, when they saw the risen Jesus, they started to say, we got to write this down because this isn't normal. We've never had anybody else that's ever risen from the dead and made the claims that Jesus made. So we've got to write this down and we've got to tell the world. To the point that these disciples that he's going to list here all gave their lives and their backs for the gospel. And apart from John, all of the disciples, and of course Judas, all of the disciples gave their lives. They were martyred for the faith. What for? What for? Some made up hoax? No, because they saw the risen Jesus. They saw him. This is a real historical fact. And I just want to point this out. What Paul is going to say in 1 Corinthians 14 is he's basically making the point to say Easter isn't really a sweet religious tradition. That's not what this is. As amazing as it is, as sweet as the tradition of Easter is, what it really is a celebration of a world-altering historical event that demands a decision. Because this is the truth. This is what's fact. And he says in verse 5, he says that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12, and after that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also as one abnormally born, for I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. He's just making the case to say, there's so many eyewitnesses. There was 500 eyewitnesses of Jesus' resurrection. Most of them are still alive. Maybe it's 450 at this time, 25 years later. But you could go to these eyewitnesses, and they would all tell you during the time that this was written, you know, some 25 years after Jesus rose again from the dead, this was written, and these accounts were already there, that you could go talk to these eyewitnesses. What he's saying is this is a historical fact, a historical event that demands a decision, to the point where, what happened with these guys? Why did these disciples change their worldview? Why did somebody like Paul go from a persecutor of the church to a preacher of the church? What happened? Why did these disciples be willing to give their lives and say, I can't deny that Jesus rose again, because there was something that they saw that they couldn't deny and they were willing to give their life for it, because the fear of death had been taken away from them, because they knew where they were going, because there was someone that came from heaven down to this earth, walked in our skin, died on the cross, told us the way back to heaven, and then he rose from the dead to prove it. Amen? And now he's in heaven. He's interceding for those of us who are believers. And because of that, the fear of death has been taken from us. And that's what we're going to talk about as we get into this. I'm not going to go through the whole chapter, chapter 15. We'll get into that in several weeks as we're going through the book of 1 Corinthians 15. But as we're going through 1 Corinthians as a book. But I'll just give you kind of a snippet of what he makes the case for next to make a few points. He starts talking about the resurrection. There was a lot of people in the Corinthian church that were skeptical of a resurrection to say, did Jesus really rise from the dead? Was this like a spiritual thing? And he's saying, no, this is a historical fact. He bodily rose. And then he says, you will rise bodily one day too if you're in Christ. You will one day rise again from the grave. In other words, Jesus on Good Friday, he went into the grave, literally died, and then on Easter, he rose again literally in his body. And in many ways, what we all experience now with death, we live in a Good Friday world and we are waiting for Easter, right? So there's no such thing as a Christian who dies and doesn't rise again. Really, the case that he makes throughout here, he starts talking about seeds being planted. The point is, what he's really saying is, you don't bury a Christian, you only plant them. That's the big point that he makes. That anybody who's a believer in Jesus, even though they die, yet they shall live. They will never die. They will rise again. And it's a bodily thing. But the reason he's making this case is because the people in this culture of Corinth, the people in this Greek culture, did not have a grid for a literal resurrection body one day. They believed that, like, you know, maybe your spirit lives on. Maybe, you know, like, we don't really know about the afterlife. And I want to make this point because there are some people in our day, and a lot of times you see this on the History Channel, and different people will say to me sometimes, you know, like, of course they believed in that because in their culture they believed in all kinds of things. And so, of course, they believed that Jesus rose from the dead. Anybody would believe that back then because they were kind of, they had an open worldview to that. But what I'm pointing out here is that's actually not the case. That Paul had to argue to them to say, your worldview of not allowing this resurrection to be a possibility needs to change. And the question is, if the majority of people in the day that Paul writes this had a worldview that didn't allow for the resurrection, yet there's thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people that are changing their worldview in a minute, that doesn't happen normally unless something really happens that makes them say, we have to face the facts and therefore change our worldview. So I'm saying that to say this. If you say, you know, if my worldview doesn't allow me to believe in, like, fairy tales or impossible things, so therefore I can't believe it, and, you know, they had that kind of allowance. Well, actually, their worldview didn't allow for it either. They just let the facts of what was reality change their worldview. So my question to you is, why should you allow your worldview to be privileged over there? What caused all these people to change their worldview? In other words, if you don't believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, or if I say my worldview can't accept that, then I actually should have, I have an obligation, if I'm saying I'm not going to accept that, I don't believe it, then I have an obligation to come up with a historically possible alternative explanation for this incredible worldview shift where all of these countless people changed their minds to believe in a resurrection when the norm in that day didn't even believe in a bodily resurrection, yet they started to believe it. So he makes the case to say, you don't bury a Christian, you only plant them. And he goes on to say that the last enemy is death, that death still exists, but it is the last enemy. And in many ways, it has already been defeated on the cross. We just haven't seen the finality of it yet. So he goes on to explain this. And so we're going to pick it up here in 1 Corinthians 15. We'll pick it up here in verse 50. He says, I declare to you, brothers, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. There is coming a literal resurrection for God's people one day. That's going to come when Jesus comes back for his church. And it says the dead in Christ in 1 Corinthians 4, it says the dead in Christ will rise first. That means if we're at a funeral and there's a dead body here, dude's going to sit up first. And then go, and then we're all going to be like, yeah, what's happening, right? This is really going to happen literally. And so then he says this. For the perishable, verse 53, must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. See, in a way, death still is in existence today. The victory has already happened, but not fully yet. And there's a reason. And he's going to say there's coming a day, though, when the resurrection happens. It's already a done deal because Jesus proved it. And it's already, whatever he said is going to happen. So we live in the remnants of it right now. We live in the remnants of waiting between Good Friday and Easter. We are, again, we're Easter people living in a Good Friday world, waiting for that day where we rise again from the grave. And so he's going to get into this idea of the sting of death. And I want to give you an opportunity at the end of this message. What he says in verse 2, if you could just bring that back up on the screen, is, by this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preach to you, otherwise you believe in vain. In other words, you got to make a decision that follows through. Just making a decision that doesn't follow through isn't what saves you. You've got to make a commitment to Jesus. And this is what saves you. You might ask, well, saves me from what, Jeff? Saves me from what? The Bible says that Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection has saved you from your sin. It saves you from the power of Satan. And it saves you from hell. Many people want to try to ignore the thought of the afterlife, but the truth is there is an afterlife, and the Bible says that there are only two places to go, heaven and hell. And Jesus came and he died for us to take away our sins so that we could spend an eternity with him, so that we could spend all of eternity with him, completely forgiven. But there really is a hell. There really is an afterlife. A lot of people don't want to think about it, but the truth is there really is an afterlife, and we need to be ready for that moment that we face him. Because every single one of us is going to die. 100% of people die, at least so far. That's a statistic, right? Until the Lord comes back, right? But every single one of us is going to die, and we're going to have to stand before God and account for our sin. And the Bible says that God's standard is perfection, that you have to have perfect righteousness in order to enter heaven. That's what the Bible says. Well, there's a problem then, Jeff, because I've got sin. I know I've done things wrong, at least. I know I've done a few things wrong. I mean, how can I go then? And here's the good news. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The gift of God is eternal life through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Through the cross. See, he takes all of our sin upon himself and he nails it to the cross, so that he can save us from judgment, so that he can save us from hell. And Jesus talked about hell. God warned us about hell in the Bible. A lot of churches don't want to talk about it anymore, but it's so clear in the scripture. Jesus even talked about it. He told a story about a guy that was a rich man that went to hell, and another guy, Lazarus, that went to his place of comfort in eternity. And he says that the person that went to hell, that never gave their life to God, that lived for themselves, that never made that decision to believe in the truth of God's word and his promises and the salvation that was available, he finds himself in torment to the point where he is crying out for someone to send him just a tip of someone's finger dropped in water to give him some sort of a quenching of the thirst as he's tormented in the flame. And as he sees from a distance the other side, he cries out that someone would come, and they say, there's a chasm, there's a problem, there's a chasm that sticks, that once you get into the eternal realm, there is no crossing from one side to the other, because this time on earth is the moment of your decision. Not then. You can't wait till then. You need to make that decision now. And so they say, you know, the place of eternal comfort replies back and says, there's a chasm fixed. I can't come from here to you, and you can't come from here to me. And then he says, well, then send Lazarus back from the dead to go tell my family and my brothers so that they won't come to this place of torment. And the answer from heaven is this. It is, if they don't believe in the scriptures, then how are they going to believe someone though they come back from the dead? See, this is God's word, and he's given us his truth, and he demands for us to make a decision. And we can't wait till we die. We can't wait till tomorrow, and we don't even know when it is that our time is going to come. But God has sent his son to save us from sin, from Satan, and from hell, and to give us a relationship because he loved us. And that's why he went to the cross. That's why he went through that pain to make a way for each and every one of us. And so he goes on to say in 1 Corinthians 55, he says, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" And this is really the point of the message today. That death, in many ways, still seems alive, but the truth is it's already been defeated. In many ways, death has already been arrested, right? We sing that song, "Death was arrested. That's when my life began." What happens when you're arrested? Has anybody here ever been arrested? You don't have to raise your hand. But usually when you're arrested, they kind of search you. They take all your weapons from you, and then they cuff you, and then they read you your rights, and then they incarcerate you to the point where you are unable to do what you used to do with the weapons that you used to. You don't have as much freedom anymore. And for the Christian, do you understand? For the Christian, death has been arrested. Whenever you are facing death, whenever you are facing different things in your life, you have the ability to say, to read death its rights. And that's really what this is. It's a taunting from Hosea 13:14, a taunting to death. To basically read death its rights and say, "Death, you have the right to remain silent. Anything you say or do will be used against you in a court of law. Because my sin has already been judged on the cross. Death has no power over me." And that's actually what he says next. And we'll get into that. But he says, where, O death, is your sting? And the idea there, does anybody have any beehives at home? Like the honeybee thing? We need to get some of these going so we can get some good honey at the church here, right? Oh, you got some, okay. I think it's honeybees. There's certain bees that when they sting a person or when they sting someone, their stinger gets left behind in the person, right? And then they fly away. But the moment that they lose their stinger, they're already a defeated bee, right? It's just a matter of time that they fly around and they drop and they fall and they die. But while they're flying around, they have no ability to sting anybody anymore. That's the idea here, that this is what's happened to death. The death has lost its sting. Where did that sting go? That sting went to the cross. That sting went to Jesus. Jesus took the sting of sin for us when he went to the cross. And yes, death is still seemingly alive and buzzing all around and everything. But if you know the truth will set you free. It doesn't have a stinger anymore. It's a defeated foe. It's going to fall. The last enemy, it will be destroyed one day. But yes, we still see it doing its thing, but it's a defeated foe. So he taunts death. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? And I would say, you know where it is? It's at the cross. That's where the sting of death is. It was at the cross so that my sin could be taken away. And that's what he says next in verse 56. The sting of death is sin. And the power of sin is the law. What does he mean? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. Well, every single one of us, when we die, we are going to have to give an account for our life. And the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, and there's also judgment on the other side. And the only perfection, or the only way to get into heaven is the perfect standard of God's law. The perfection is God's standard. And so if any of us die in our sin and we face God on judgment day with even one sin, it makes us fall short of the perfection standard of God. So that means by God's law, by God's perfect righteous standard, we need to be judged and condemned for our sins. But here's the good news. Jesus went to the cross and he took our sin. He became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus took our place on that cross to take our sin away so that when we put our faith in Jesus, legally, we are looked at as righteous, that when we stand before God after we die, he no longer sees our sin, because the Bible says that he took our sin, the portfolio of all the things that we've ever done wrong, and he nailed them to the cross. I have the verse for you. It's Colossians chapter 2. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us. What does it say? Some of our sins, He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. See, we all have a portfolio of our lives, and the truth is we cannot outweigh the good with the bad because the standard is perfection. And every single one of us, when we die and we get into the other side of eternity, we will have a day where we stand before God and the books will be open. The books of all of the things that we've ever done wrong, even to the most minute sin. And if we have any sin, we will find ourselves in a dangerous place. But the Bible says that God took that portfolio of your sin and gave it to Jesus on the cross, and Jesus nailed my portfolio of all my sin, Jeff's portfolio of all his sin, past, present, and future, is on that cross right now. He nailed it to the cross when Jesus died because he took my sin. He took the sting of death in my place. And when I go stand before God, you know what God's going to do? He's going to open a book, or maybe the angel Gabriel, I'm not sure, right? He's going to open a book, and the only thing it's going to say is, Jeff Brower, the righteousness of Christ. Why? Because Jesus took my portfolio and he gave me his. Because if the righteous perfection is the only standard by which we can be saved, we can get into heaven, then each and every one of us needed a Savior that took our place. And so when death comes and hell comes for me on judgment day, legally, and this is what he means by the law here, when death comes for a believer, legally it can't hold them down in the grave because the law says they have to have sin in order to stay in the grave. But for the saved child of God, legally they have no sin anymore because it's all been wiped away. It is no more, so death can't hold them down. And that's good news. The books are open and it reads the righteousness of Christ because Jesus took my portfolio and he nailed it to the cross. All my sins he nailed to the cross. And a lot of people live their lives with a fear of death. With a fear of death. And, you know, wondering, what about the afterlife? What about, how do we even know? And a lot of people, you know, the world will kind of tell you, oh, don't worry about it. You're just like a drop in the ocean. You'll just kind of go back into the ocean and everything will be fine. You just kind of cease to exist. We can tell ourselves all of these things, but I think deep down, each and every person wonders and has some sort of a inkling of eternity because the Bible says that God has placed eternity in our hearts. That there is something to be thinking about the afterlife. Let me give you a quote from a pagan philosopher named Epicurus who was several centuries ago. He looked at death. He wasn't a Christian, but he looked at death from the most objective way. He was a philosopher, and he says this: if we could be sure that death was annihilation, then there'd be no fear of it. For as long as we exist, death is not there, and when it does come, we no longer exist. But we cannot be totally sure that it is annihilation. What people fear most is not that maybe death is annihilation, but that maybe death is not. See, what he's saying is that we can't be totally sure that there's an afterlife, but we also can't be totally sure that there isn't either. We can't be totally sure that there isn't a judgment. Unless, here's where I come in, unless someone who claimed what he claimed rose from the dead and defeated death and came back to tell us. And again, you might say, well, death seems pretty alive to me still. Well, it's alive, but it's a defeated foe. It's been arrested. That's why he says in verse 57, but thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The victory over our fear of death. See, when I became a Christian, the fear of death went away. And you know what I found is that when I had no more fear of death, I had no more fear to live either. Right? I had the ability to just live and not live in fear. Hebrews 2:14 through 15, it says, since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. Anybody here have any fears? I have a fear of water. I couldn't tell anybody this. Whenever I'm swimming in, like, deep areas, I get really creeped out. It's called hydrophobia. I was just looking into it. I guess that's the one thing I fear. So don't mess with me. I'm just being vulnerable. There's another fear, a fear of closed spaces. What's that called? Claustrophobia. Then there's the fear of spiders, which is called what? Arachnophobia. Then there is the fear of the number 13, which is called what? You don't know that, right? It's called triadicophobia. Anyway, something like that, the fear of the number 13. This is a real thing. But the Bible says that there's a fear, there's a phobia of death that each and every one of us really have, but deep down, we don't know. And the truth is that fear can be taken away. If you have that fear, if you don't know where you're going when you die, if you don't know that when you stand before God that you will be saved, that you will be allowed into eternity to spend eternity with him, you can know that today. You need to be forgiven of your sin. You need to be saved. You need to make a decision that is a commitment to him to say, I want to trust in you. I want to accept this gift from you, Jesus. So in closing, death is not the last word for the Christian. Amen? Death does not have to be the last chapter in the story of our life, and death is not the last chapter in the story of the world, because Jesus defeated death. And death, the death on the cross, we oftentimes say that the death on the cross was the payment for our sin, but the resurrection was the receipt. How many people here know whenever you go to certain stores like Sam's, you ain't allowed out unless you show them your receipt, right? So a lot of times I'll have that receipt ready for the highlighter dude to highlight my receipt. It's like, it's paid for in full, highlighter right there, come on. So we can live around, we can walk around as Christians living without the fear of death now, because we see that the payment has been paid in full, and the receipt is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Whenever you start to get afraid of death, just look to the resurrection, look to the empty tomb. It's a done deal. There's nothing to fear. Jesus rose again from the grave. He proved that he had power over death, and he promised. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live. Even though they die, whoever lives believing in me will never die. See, we just move from one location to the next, and we close our eyes here. We open our eyes in eternity, and one day is coming when our bodies will be resurrected, and we will be in the fullness of the resurrection body in reality. So we are Easter people living in a Good Friday world. Watchman Nee said the greatest negative in the universe is the cross. For with it, God wiped out everything that was not of himself. And the greatest positive in the universe is the resurrection. For through it, God brought all things into being. So we've been given the victory in Jesus Christ. It's been said that Jesus is the only one who could borrow a tomb and give it back when he was finished with it. That's a pretty strong statement. So, first the team, you can come up and we'll get back to our riddle here. I know you guys have been waiting. You're like, I really wanted to walk out a long time ago, but because of that riddle. So there's six crows sitting on a fence. Four of them decide to fly away. How many are left? I heard six. Got it. Good job. Why? Because four of them decided to fly away, but they didn't follow through with their decision. You guys are so mad at me right now. I know, right? And this is the point that I wanted to make today. That God is calling you. If you want to give your life to Jesus today, this is a decision that he's calling you to make. And this is not just a decision to just kind of make a one-time decision and then not have it change your life. It's a decision that you have to hold firmly to, that you willingly say, I'm making a commitment to follow Jesus. Any decision you make with no follow-through is worthless. And, you know, last night I was up in my office just kind of going through my studying of this message, just trying to put my thoughts together and just praying through, you know, just really, really praying through, giving an invitation for people to be saved this morning. And as I was up there in my office a little later at night, my son Malachi, my 13-year-old son Malachi, comes up and he's talking to me and he's asking me about the message. And, you know, he's like, what are you going to say, Dad? And I'm like, well, he's like, do you have it ready? And I'm like, well, I don't know if I'm ever really ready, but, you know, I just have it on my heart to give an invitation. I'm just praying about whether to have people raise their hands or come forward or stand. I said, what do you think? And he said, you know what, Dad, I think you should just make them stand, because if they're not willing to stand, then maybe they're not really serious about giving their life to Jesus. I said, whoa, I need you to be my partner and drive from that. And, you know, then I went back to my study in 1 Corinthians 15, and the first verse I read was this, just to confirm it. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. So I'm going to give an invitation for those of you who have never given your life, you've never been saved, you've never had a moment where you've made that conscious decision to put your faith in Jesus, to ask him to forgive you of your sins, to wipe your sin away. You've never made that commitment to Christ. I'm going to ask you in a few moments to take a stand, to stand for him and say, I want that. I want to make that decision, and I want it to be a follow-through decision. And I'm willing to stand to let the world know, to let all of the world know, to let all of the church know, to let all of the angelic world know that I am making this decision to follow Jesus. See, the Bible says that you are the reward of his suffering. Jesus died to have you. And I believe that if you're in here and you've never been saved, maybe this is the first time you ever even walked into a church, or maybe you're somebody that grew up in church, but you never really understood the gospel. It's never clicked until right now. Or maybe you committed to the Lord, but you didn't hold on to it firmly, and you've wandered and you strayed. You want to recommit your life. You want to make a recommitment to Christ this morning. I'm going to invite you in a minute. First time or a recommitment to Christ, I'm going to invite you in a minute to stand. But I want you to know that the reason that you're here today is not coincidence. It's because Jesus wanted you here for this moment. He wanted you to know that he loves you with a love. That he died with a broken heart, thinking about those who would just reject this decision. And don't think that if you don't make this decision, you're not making a decision. Because to not make a decision is to make a decision. He is offering salvation. He's offering a changed life. He will come and live inside of you and make his home within you and give you a new life and a new heart and change your desires to want to live for him. And you will overflow with love and joy and grace and peace as you get to know him and as you get into his word. And you will have that peace of being able to face any suffering, knowing that he's with you. Now, why did these disciples be able to face lions and be ripped to shreds for their faith? Because they knew the risen Savior and the fear of death was taken. How can we as believers face things? Maybe we're not facing lions, but maybe we're facing lumps. Maybe we're facing different things that are sicknesses or illnesses. How can we face those things? If the fear of death is taken away, we can face it all, because the legal ramifications of my sin have been paid for on the cross. But we've got to make a decision to follow through with it. Jesus died to have you, and it would break your heart all over again for you to reject that invitation, because you are the reward of his suffering. So let's pray, and in a moment again, I'm gonna count to three, and we're gonna ask anybody who wants to commit to Jesus for the first time or make a recommitment to Jesus and be saved from all your sins to stand. So, Lord, thank you so much for your grace and your mercy. And I just pray that as your Holy Spirit has been speaking through your word this morning, that you would tug the hearts of all of those who right now hear your voice calling them home, hearing you call them to give their lives to you, to make a commitment to Christ. Lord, if they feel glued to their chair, Lord, would you just break that in the name of Jesus right now. Allow them to be able to step into your presence in this moment right now and receive the free gift of grace by just opening their heart up to you and allowing you to come in. We pray this in Jesus' name. And then on the count of three, I want everybody who's making that commitment today to stand. One, Jesus loves you. Two, Jesus will never let you go, never leave you or forsake you. Three, stand up right where you are. Anybody that wants to give that commitment to Jesus, stand up right where you are. Amen, amen. Stand up, go ahead. Remember, this decision is a decision that will change your life forever. Amen. Amen. Stand, yeah, right where you are. Maybe you came with a friend and you're afraid to stand by yourself. You can talk to your friend and say, would you stand with me? Would you just stand with me? I want to know that when I die, I'm going to go be with him. I want to know this risen Savior that died to have me. Amen. Amen. We're going to have the prayer team available as well. If you guys could remain standing, if a few of you, believers in Jesus, just come around these people that are standing, just lay your hands on them. Let's lead them in a prayer right now. Go ahead. Everybody go ahead and just find someone that's standing and put your hands on them, and let's pray for them right now. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer. The Bible says that anybody who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So this is just a heartfelt call to Jesus. Say, Jesus, save me. I want to be saved. I want to be forgiven of all my sins. I want to know without a shadow of a doubt that all of my sin has been canceled. So just pray this. Lord Jesus, Lord, forgive me of all my sins. Save my soul. Secure me for eternity. Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit. I believe in what you did on the cross for me, and I pray that you would just continue to pursue me the rest of my life. Change me, make me new, come into my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit continually. I make this decision now. And help me to be able to follow through by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all give those people a hand one more time. Amen. You know, the Bible says that if even one sinner comes to repentance, that heaven is rejoicing. And heaven is rejoicing today because there were several people that stood for Jesus and gave their life to Jesus during the first service as well. Today is a day where I believe all over the planet people are coming to Jesus. And you can remember from this day forward that this is your birthday. On Easter Sunday, and I know it kind of the date changes every year, but you can just remember Easter Sunday, right? Write this down because this is your moment. This is the moment that God has saved you, that he's put a stamp of approval on you to say, you are mine. You never have to wonder anymore, am I too far gone? Am I unforgivable? Am I going to be condemned? Therefore, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. The old is gone, the new has come. But I would encourage you, amen. I would encourage you to follow through. I would encourage you to follow through with this decision. What that means is get involved in church. Find some on-ramps. If you're not from around here, find a good Bible-believing church and get involved there. Get a Bible. We'd love to give you one on your way out if you don't have one. And, you know, have some time of prayer, and we're going to have a baptism in a few months available, maybe even weeks. We'll see. We would encourage you to follow through with some of these things. But we're going to close with a song. You can all stand. And this song really is song of declaration to the fact that death has been defeated. Thank you. Death has been defeated and we have been made new. Amen.
Anybody need prayer at all during this time as well? We'll have some prayer ministry people available afterwards. If you came to the faith, come. Today was your day of salvation. Make sure you talk to somebody that you came with. Talk to one of the pastors, one of the prayer people up here. We want to get you plugged in. We want you to know how to walk with Jesus. And if you want to come up, I'd love to meet you. Now I
We know the answer, right? Let's sing it loud. Come on. This morning. Amen. God bless you. Happy Easter. Happy Resurrection. We love you. Have a great day in the Lord. And if anybody needs prayer or wants to talk, please come up and find a prayer ministry team leader. I'd love to meet you too if I haven't met you. God bless you. Oh, and feel free to take some pictures up here so some of your families will move the mic.